Michael, you've covered Maryland extensively, working in Washington in the newspaper industry. When were you fully convinced that Len Bias was more than just an outstanding player, but perhaps a transcendent superstar?
Recently, everybody has their stories who watched Lenny play, as I did, every game pretty much his first 2 years in Maryland. I think it was his sophomore year where he dunks and he comes down, a reverse dunk, and he comes down and he lands on the shoulders of Brad Daugherty, who's 6'11". Lands on Brad Daugherty. And you're looking, I remember sitting on the baseline looking at this thinking, my God, who can do this? And the other thing is, I mean, back then when reporters got to go to practice and Coach Drizzell, who you're going to have on in this hour, would allow me to come to practice. I remember going in one day and Len was showing me how he could shoot a little jump hook right-handed and left-handed. And we see it in one of those clips where he shot it right-handed. I don't know that he ever shot it in a game left-handed. But he was just a tireless worker. And between the talent and the work, I mean, he allowed a teammate, Keith Gatlin, the point guard on those Maryland teams, to blindfold him and make him handle the ball without looking down at it so his ball handling could become better at 6'8". And so you had this incredible confluence of, you know, assets, if you will. And I never saw a big man shoot a jump shot. Remember, people weren't shooting jump shots like they are now. I never saw a guy 6'8 shoot a jump shot like that then or since. And those clips, and you heard Jay Billis talk about it, it was like art. And to see him do this all the time, I think all of us projected. I remember in Lefty Drizzell's office, he had these big blocks and it had the faces of his All-Americans over time. You know, Tom McMillan and John Lucas and Len Elmore and Albert King and on and on. And there was a face for the next one and it had a question mark. And I remember writing for the Washington Post when Len, at the end of that freshman year, the next face would be Len Bias's face. And of course it was. And it wasn't, you didn't need to be a full-time, fully employed NBA scout to see that Len Bias had greatness in him like few people at the college level had greatness in them.
You touched on it in your essay. How do you envision the rivalry between Len Bias and Michael Jordan going had Bias lived and played in the NBA?
Well, I think recent, everybody you've talked to and everybody you will talk to couldn't help but make that comparison because they shared a little time on the court. And so when you looked at Bias, and Mike Krzyzewski says, I mean, they're basically two, in terms of athleticism, two peerless players that he saw at his time in the ACC. That was 24 years in to Mike Krzyzewski's coaching career, and it was Bias and Jordan. So that comparison, everybody who watched the ACC back then made it. And just he was so good. I mean, he was so talented. He's going to go to a Celtics team and practice with Bird, McHale, and Parrish every day and Dennis Johnson and be coached hard. And he was fine with that. Remember, I mean, that's sort of like Tim Duncan going to San Antonio and practicing with David Robinson every day and being coached by Greg Popovich. I mean, Len Bias would have had that sort of push to his immediate early career, the start of his career. And so presuming health, why wouldn't you think that Len would have progressed, that he would have fit into that Celtic team seamlessly, that Bird and McHale specifically would not have had the minutes played that wore them out early, and you'd have him playing against the Pistons and the Bulls and the Sixers in the East, and it would have been something to behold. There's no reason, if you project reasonably, that you don't come to that conclusion.
Michael, why do you think 34 years after this tragedy that, and I understand there's a generation of fans that don't know Len Bias, and maybe they will by the end of the night, but why is he so captivating and compelling still?
I think there are a number of reasons. I mean, we were going through something, for those of us who were alive and of age in 1986, you look at the top of the draft, and you look at William Bedford, Chris Washburn, you know, you look at guys who were unbelievably talented, and Roy Tarpley, and substance abuse was either part of what undid them or undid them. And it wasn't just something that was symptomatic of basketball or sports. It was the culture at the time. I mean, you look at so many industries in the mid-1980s, and particularly we see it showing up there in that NBA draft. And I think that people who weren't alive or weren't of age, they look back and they say, what in the world was going on in the country then? And of course, it's a legitimate question. And the other part to that is, he stays with us because he was captivating. I mean, there was an athletic arrogance. I mean, I got to know Lenny in his first 2 years better. I wasn't around every game for his last 2 years at Maryland, but there was an athletic arrogance that was completely reasonable. He knew how good he had made himself. He knew that there was greatness in him, and he sort of responded accordingly. I mean, nothing was over his head. You know, he played in the game against Hakeem Olajuwon in Houston, and he held his own, and he's on the court with Hakeem, and you're going, oh my God, what's going to happen with this kid? So I think that those of us who watched him, we can't get enough of it. We can't forget how he died, how he learned of it, as Jay told you. We can't forget the way he looked on the court. I told you, I don't. You can go back and look at that jump shot. You can have anybody break it down you want. And you just sort of fantasize about what he would have been. And I just think that combination of circumstances has led a great many of us to lament what was. I mean, what happened throughout the country at that period of time, what happened in sports that period of time, and certainly what happened to Len Bias in that specific time. I can still remember the date. I mean, June 19, 1986. And sadly, Reese, everything about it.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.